You know, this album is a kind of jazz album, too, and jazz means the blues. Oscar, Barney, Alvin, and Ray are going to ad-lib some of those blues now, and I'm going to walk in and throw a little hoofing in there.
The voice of Fred Astaire. In the January 28, 1953 issue of Downbeat magazine, critic Leonard Feather's heading read, "The Astaire Story," another milestone in the Grand's career. I'm Nat Hentoff, and tonight's Out of the Norm, it's Grand's Last Stand. Feather's article went on to note that Norman Granz displayed the most ambitious venture of his decade-long recording career when he launched The Astaire Story on Clef Records with a $50 splash last month. That was big bucks 50 years ago. Spread over three LPs, Astaire revisited, at Granz's request, 34 of the songs written for him to sing in his movies by, among others, Irving Berlin, the Gershwins, and Cole Porter. Backed by such Jazz at the Philharmonic stalwarts as Oscar Peterson, Ray Brown, Barney Kessel, Alvin Stoller, Flip Phillips, and Charlie Shavers, Astaire was in his element. And as he pointed out, was moved to throw in a little hoofing as a bonus. Fred Astaire recorded late in 1952. Fast forward from the Astaire session to Tokyo 1983 and the final night of the final Jazz at the Philharmonic tour.
Thank you. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Tonight we have the last of our two concerts in Tokyo with Jazz at the Philharmonic. And I want to tell you that on behalf of all the musicians and myself, that we were very happy to be able to play in Japan after 30 years of JATP's absence. Thank you.
Norman Granz bringing down the curtain on Jazz at the Philharmonic 39 years after he first presented the concept at the Philharmonic Auditorium in Los Angeles. At the time of that 1983 Japanese tour, Granz was 66 years old. And though his road days were over, his fifth record label, Pablo, formed in 1974, continued to keep him busy. Jazz historian and broadcaster Bob Porter.
I think Norman recorded the music that he liked, but first he recorded the people he liked.
I read a lot about all kinds of difficulties that people have had with various jazz musicians or with singers like Billie Holiday. I've always had a theory that if you treated anyone with respect, they would reciprocate. But you know, again, people look to jazz and they use a standard, yet I'm sure Maria Callas must have missed a gig here and there. So it's not unique. You're always reading of an actor storming off a set because the director doesn't do things properly. That's not special. But why jazz gets that kind of attention, I don't know, maybe the first violinist at the LSO doesn't make time. You know, there's nothing new about that.
I think he just loved the musicians and the music so much that he felt that he had to do something to make it more accepted in the world. And he so revered Duke and Roy Eldridge and Coleman Hawkins and Benny Carter and all of the musicians who played for him. He'd give an opinion, but the artist was made the final decision, and I appreciated that. He would speak his mind. He would tell them when he thought that they were not playing their best. He would say it, whether they liked it or not.
Oscar Peterson. During the Pablo years, Norman Granz produced some intriguing albums. For instance, a Duke Ellington and Ray Brown duet session, Peterson coming together with trumpeter Freddie Hubbard, and European concert performances by tenor saxophonist John Coltrane, taped in 1962 and not previously issued. Then there were several fascinating Basie dates. Here's Bob Porter again.
Norman never cared for Basie's big band. When it comes to Basie, what he liked was the small group things with Basie and the sessions with Basie and Oscar together.
Count Basie and Oscar Peterson jumping at the Woodside from their 1975 Pablo release, proving beyond doubt that at least in pianistic terms, opposites do attract. I'm Nat Hentoff with Out of the Norm, The Life and Times of Norman Granz on BBC Radio 2.